So, you're from London. Trying to sell Eel Marsh House.
Yes.
You won't find a local buyer.
Hello, welcome to Premier Scene. I'm Claire Bueno. Well, it's been a book, it's been a play, and now it's a Hammer horror screenplay. We attend the world premiere of The Woman in Black, starring the one and only Daniel Radcliffe.
The sooner the house is sold, the sooner people can move on.
Now, I believe you were looking for a ghost story to direct. How did you get involved with the script?
Well, it was really weird, actually, because I'd heard that the script was knocking about, and I asked my agent about it, and then purely coincidentally, it came my way. And I just thought it was a fantastic script. Jane's a fantastic writer, it's a pleasure to work with, and I just thought this is a really interesting project, because it had real heart as well as horror, you know, and the ambition of that is somewhat greater, and I like the kind of the old school notion of it, just going back to playing on people's imagination rather than necessarily playing on gore and violence and nastiness to create scares. I thought that was a very interesting challenge.
You've got a lead actor as well, obviously, in Daniel Radcliffe, but how important was it to have an actor that has the maturity for such a young part?
It's very important. I mean, you know, if the character is a man who has lost his wife and is grieving, and you need someone that can do justice to that. And Dan was very mindful of that and really did his prep and, you know, met with grief counsellors and researched the subject and read Victorian books on grief and really got into it and really explored that.
And also the film is obviously very atmospheric and creepy. How technically did you create those effects?
Scares are, it's very technical, the creation of scares. You have to really work at it, and it's all about the flow, and it's like creating a joke, I suppose, with comedians. You have to test it and work it and build it. It's tough. You want to make it look easy, but it's quite technically tricky.
I mean, obviously lighting is everything to do with filmmaking, but have you had to work on the lighting even more?
Is a fantastically huge part of it. I mean, we really wanted, you know, you wanted really a real depth in the frame, real shadows and light, a sense that there's always a sense that somebody could jump out at you from somewhere in the frame, you know, peeking into the darkness, not quite sure, real contrast in the image, not quite sure what you can see.
Now you're the Woman in Black. I believe you've had to go through extensive makeup. What was that like?
It was hardcore, actually. It was glue. It was really smelly glue. So, and this thing called green marble. And so I won't stick my head back just in case I've got a hairy nose, but I had to put all this stuff on my face and twizzle it around. And you'd have like three makeup heads hovering in your eye and you couldn't really move. So it was a very odd experience. And then to dry the glue, a hairdryer, to make it really crisp up. So it was quite an odd experience, yeah.
Looking back, you know, obviously being an actor, you being on camera is really important because your next job is your next work. And if you're potentially covered up, how does that affect you?
Oh, well, that's never a reason not to do the part, you know, because to play such an iconic figure, my God, you know, I can't believe that I've been given this chance, and it's just wonderful. And you know, I'm Liz White playing the Woman in Black. It makes perfect sense.
She's there.
Can't leave yet.
Tell us how you got involved with the part and the script.
I got involved because James had worked with me on Eden Lake, and phoned me and just said, "Would you like to come and play?" And then sent me the script, and I was just going to do it anyway, regardless, because I love James and I love working with him. I love what he brings to projects. So I read the script, scared me to bits, the script, because it's a really frightening script. And it was just like, yeah, straight away. It wasn't really about the part or anything in a way. It was just about being part of the project.
It's legendary, isn't it?
Yeah, completely. And, you know, we've all seen the stage production. We've all been frightened by the stage production. I was scared to death. Oh, I was so frightened. When she walks down at the end,
I had to sleep with the light on, and that's the truth.
It wasn't good, was it? It was really good. Oh, you know.
Is it difficult creating that, do you think, for, you know, transferring it from stage to screen?
Don't think it was, because that's the problem, is it? Because when people go, oh, what do you play? They go, oh, hang on. And all you can remember is the two guys that were there on stage doing it, doing everything. So as far as you're concerned, there's two parts in it, you know, which can't essentially, there is in a way. But I've totally forgot your question.
I think it was transferring it from stage to screen.
No, I think she. Yeah, I think she went more from book to screen in a way. So, yeah, went more on that really. So.
I know Jane was specific as well about creating a character arc for all the supporting actors, yeah, as well as Daniels. Did you find that as well reading the play?
Yeah, absolutely. They really wanted. They didn't want the locals, as it were, to be, you know, just in the slaughtered lamb and, you know, you made me miss. I love Glover, but you know, to be just kind of shunted to the side. They wanted them to feel like they had some kind of emotional investment in it, which they have. You know, they've lost their children, these people, and this, as far as they're concerned, although we're looking at an environment where it's a ghost story, this is a real occurrence where these children are being taken and these children are dying. And so it was important for the ghost story to work. I think you've got to make the reality work and the real people work. I think the villagers work.
You should have left. You should have gone when we told you to.
You said you have a son. Go home to him.
I just wanted to ask you if you could share with us like the process of how you kind of stripped the story down to its bare bones from the book to adapt it into a, what, 95-page screenplay?
Yeah, well, it's quite a slim book. It's a novella, so that, you know, there's the element of you're more kind of trying to give it a cinematic sort of pacing, and so sometimes that means stripping things down and sometimes it means adding layers. It's always a bit of a balancing act.
The play as well, is there's a simplicity to the play. Did you want to also transfer that over into the screenplay as well?
Well, I think the play is such a perfect piece of adaptation for theatre, and it's told entirely in the language of theatre, and so no, this is really just based on Susan Hill's wonderful book.
Sorry, go on. No, I just wanted to ask as well, you did Jane Goldman investigate, so do you have a genuine interest in the paranormal?
I have an interest. I'm not a believer in the paranormal. That was such a long time ago that I'd forgotten I did that. I've always had an interest. I love ghost stories, but I'm not a believer, but I think the stories are fascinating.
How did you evolve as an actor from doing this part?
There's a huge amount of non-verbal stuff in this film, which I think is probably, you know, I probably learned a lot from. I think I also learned a lot just from working with James, our director, in terms of direction, like in terms of watching him work, it was really kind of inspirational, because just the focus and the clarity and the fact that he never misses any opportunity to continue telling the story, be it through costume or makeup or set, you know, he's a fantastic director.
Don't go chasing shadows, Arthur.
An eerie night in old London town as we attended the world premiere of The Woman in Black, starring the one and only Daniel Radcliffe. I'm Claire Bueno and you're watching Premiere Scene.
She's always there.